Welcome students to the science class. In today's science class, we will be starting with the first chapter, that is living world and classification of microbes. So first, let us see what are all the things that we are going to learn. So first is biodiversity and need of classification. Here we are going to learn about what is biodiversity and why does it need classification. Okay? Then is the five kingdom system, then the characteristics of the kingdom, that is Monera, Protista and Fungi. Then at last, we will be studying about the classification of microbes. Now students, before starting with the actual topic, let us first recall some things. So the first question in recall is, what is the hierarchy for classification of living organisms? So this is the hierarchy, where kingdom is on the topmost level, then phylum, then next is class, next is order, then family, genus, and then last is the species. Okay, so these are the seven steps, or you can say hierarchy for classification of living organisms. Now next question is, who invented binomial system of nomenclature? You know what is nomenclature, right? Nomenclature is a system where you give scientific name to animals or plants or certain species or organisms. Okay? So who invented binomial system of nomenclature? It was Carl Linnaeus who invented the system of binomial nomenclature. And Carl Linnaeus in 1735 divided living world into two kingdoms, that is Vegetabilia and Animalia. Okay, so basically in Vegetabilia all the plants are included, whereas in Animalia all the animals are included. Now let us look at the third question. Which levels of hierarchy are considered while writing the name in binomial nomenclature? Now students, previously we saw the levels of hierarchy. There are seven levels of hierarchy. They are kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus and species. Now from these levels of hierarchy, which are the levels that are considered while writing the name in binomial nomenclature? This is the question which is asked. So let us look at the answer. All living species are named using two terms. They are a generic, a name which denotes genus, and second one is a specific, a name which denotes the species. So as you can see that genus and species, these two levels are considered to write the binomial nomenclature name. Now to write the name in binomial nomenclature, there are some rules that we have to follow. So let us look at the rule. The first part is always the generic name and it's always written in italic and starts with a capital letter. Here, the first part, that is, there are two terms, right? Binomial means, bi means two. So there are two terms. So out of those two terms, the first part of the name is always going to be generic name. And how it is written in italic font and always starts with a capital letter. Whereas the second part is the species and it is also written in italic font. So generic name followed by specific name in hierarchy is used in writing the names in binomial nomenclature. Example, Homo sapiens. Homo sapiens are nothing but humans. This is the scientific name given to the humans. Now here you can see that the first term comes from the generic part, or it is a generic name. And sapiens comes from the second part, that is the species. Also you can see that the first part has the first letter capital. So these are the rules which you need to keep in mind when you are writing the scientific names, that is the names which are written using the binomial nomenclature. Okay, now finally let us move towards biodiversity and need of classification. Now students, what is biodiversity? So bio means life and diversity means variety. So from this picture we can say that where there is a variety of life form, that is called a biodiversity, right? So It refers to all the variety of life that can be found on Earth, like plants, animals, fungi, and other microorganisms. So there are variety of living organisms on the Earth as well as in the water. So all these together, we call it as biodiversity. Now, next point says that living organisms on Earth have adapted according to geographic regions, food ingestion and defense, etc. Now, here in this picture, you can see that the animals are adapted to the geographic region, that is camel. Also, cactus plants, we find them in the desert area, whereas polar bears, penguins, and we find them in the snow areas. So the animals adapt according to the geographic region. In simple terms, they adapt to their environment. Also, food ingestion. Now, what is food ingestion? That is whatever food they eat. And defense means how they protect themselves from the predators or dangers. According to 2011 census, around 87 million species of living organisms are found on Earth, including land and sea. Now, students, there were 87 million species that were found in the sea as well as on the land. So then, to study such a big number, they were divided into groups and subgroups based on the similarities and the differences they showed. So let's take a simple example over here just for you to understand. There are four-legged animals as well as there are two-legged animals also. So now all the four-legged animals were considered into one group and all the two-legged animals were considered into the other group. So like that, based on the similarities and differences that were seen, the species were divided into groups and subgroups. The process of dividing living organisms into groups and subgroups is called biological classification. Students, this is the definition of biological classification. Please study this definition because it might be asked in the exam for 1 or 2 marks. Now, let us move towards the second part, which is five kingdom system. Now, students, there was a scientist named Robert Harding Whitaker. He was an American ecologist and in 1969, he divided the living organisms into five groups. So now let us see through this diagram. So first, the living organisms were divided into prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Okay, you know what is prokaryotes? They do not have a defined nucleus, or you can say they do not have a through nucleus. So in prokaryotes, there is unicellular, that means single cell. Unicellular means only one cell. And under unicellular, we have kingdom 1, that is the first kingdom, that is Monera. Whereas on the next side, you have eukaryotes. So basically, eukaryotes have a well-defined nucleus and cell organelles. And they are divided into unicellular as well as multicellular. Now, under unicellular, you have kingdom 2, that is protista, okay? And in eukaryotes, again, on the other side, that is in multicellular, multicellular means there are more than one cells. So, in multicellular, we have 1, 2 and 3 kingdoms. So, that is kingdom 3, fungi. Cell walls present, but organisms can't perform photosynthesis. Now, here in fungus or fungi, they cannot perform photosynthesis. Okay. We all know that fungus usually grows on other foodstuffs. It cannot produce its own food. So that's what it says. Now next kingdom is kingdom 4, that is plantae. Cell walls present and organisms can perform photosynthesis. Now here in kingdom plantae, that is it includes all the plants. So in that, the cell wall is present and they can perform photosynthesis or they can produce their own food. Kingdom 5 is Animalia. Here, no cell wall is present. You know that in animal cells, there is no cell wall. Now let's move forward. For classification, Whitaker considered following criteria. Now let's see what criteria did Whitaker consider while dividing all these kingdoms. So the first one is complexity of cell. First he divided the living organism looking at the complexity of the cell structure. So first he divided the living organisms based on the cell structure, the complexity of the cell structure. That means prokaryotes and eukaryotes. So here you can see in this diagram there are prokaryotes and there are eukaryotes. Now let's see the next step. So his second criteria is complexity of organisms. That means whether they are unicellular or whether they are multicellular. So again, as you can see in this diagram, prokaryotes, under that you can see unicellular, and also here you get unicellular as well as multicellular organisms. Now his third criteria was mode of nutrition. Now if we see plants, they are autotrophic. That means they can produce their own food with the help of photosynthesis. Whereas if we see the fungus absorbs from the dead organisms. That is why they are also called as saprophytic or saprophyte. And animals are heterotrophic and ingestive. That is, they depend on other animals or plants for their food. The next criteria is lifestyle. Now, what is the lifestyle of plants? They are producers in an ecosystem. Plants are always the producers, right? After that, animals. Animals are the consumers. And after animal comes the fungi, that is the decomposers. After a certain organism dies, it is decomposed. The fifth and the last criteria, phylogenetic relationship. In this relationship, the organisms are arranged according to their evolution. Okay, for example, let us take humans. We all know that humans evolved from monkeys. The ancestors of human beings were monkeys. In the similar way, the prokaryotic cell was evolved into eukaryotic cells, which means that eukaryotic cell was first prokaryotic. After some changes in the prokaryotic cell, it got evolved into eukaryotic cell. And similarly, unicellular also became multicellular. Or you can say unicellular was evolved into multicellular. So these are the five criteria on which the Whitaker or Robert Harding Whitaker, he divided the organisms. Let's move forward. Now let us see the characteristics of the kingdom. So first we are going to see the characteristics of Monera. Then we are going to see the characteristics of Protista and then the fungi. So kingdom Monera. So now first let us look at the video of the activity and then we will continue with the characteristics.
Let us study about kingdom Monera with the help of a small activity. Activity: take a small drop of curd or buttermilk on a clean glass slide. Add one drop of water on it to dilute. Now, carefully put a clean cover slip on the slide with the help of a mounting needle. Observe this prepared slide first under low power and then under high power of a compound microscope. What do you see under the microscope? We see small, rod-shaped microbes moving under the microscope. These are Lactobacilli bacteria. They belong to kingdom Monera. Some examples of organisms belonging to kingdom Monera are Staphylococcus aureus, Streptococcus pneumoniae, Clostridium tetanae, Clostridium botulinum, Salmonella typhi, Vibrio cholera, Legionella pneumophila, and Tryponema pallidum.
So now students, under the microscope, what did you see? You saw a small rod-like bacteria, or you can say microbes, that were moving, right? So all types of bacteria and blue-green algae are included in this kingdom. That is kingdom Monera. And these are some of the organisms from kingdom Monera. out of all this, you can just learn 2 to 3 names, because sometimes the question might come, write the characteristics of kingdom Monera with 2 or 3 examples. So in that case, you should be able to write 2 or 3 names. So now let us see the characteristics. The first one says that all the organisms are unicellular. Now in kingdom Monera, all the organisms are unicellular. That is, they have only one cell. The second one says that they may be autotrophic or heterotrophic. Now what is autotrophic? Autotrophic means they can produce their own food. Or heterotrophic? Heterotrophic means they depend on others for their food or nutrition. The third one says these are prokaryotic cells without distinct nucleus or cell organelles. Now as I have said earlier also, that prokaryotic cells, they do not have the distinct nucleus, or even the cell organelles are not distinct. Now next, let us see kingdom Protista. Now again, here we will watch a small video of the activity.
Activity: collect water from a pond. Take a drop of it on a clean glass slide. Now put a clean cover slip on it with the help of a mounting needle. This is a temporary mount of pond water. Observe this temporary mount first under low power and then under high power of a compound microscope. What is observed under the microscope? We see irregular shaped microbes moving under the microscope. These are amoeba. They belong to kingdom Protista.
Okay, so now let us see the characteristics. Now the first characteristic says that Protista are single-celled organisms with well-defined nucleus enclosed in a nuclear membrane. It means that they are unicellular, only with one cell, but they have well-defined nucleus and they are enclosed in a nuclear membrane. Second one is, they have pseudopodia or hair-like cilia or whip-like flagella for locomotion. Now, these organisms in the Protista kingdom, they move. Now, if they want to go from one place to another, they have this thread-like structure or thread-like cilia or a whip with which they move, or they go from one place to another. And this process, when they move from one place to another using cilia or whip-like flagella, it is called as pseudopodia. Okay? The third one is autotrophs. Again, autotrophs, that means you know that they produce their own food. So, for example, Euglena, Volvox contain chloroplast. That is this one. Volvox and Euglena, these two, they contain chloroplast. You can see that they are green in color. And we also know that chloroplast is green in color. So, these two contains chloroplast and they are autotrophs. Okay? Heterotrophs. Example, amoeba and paramecium. Now here, this is the paramecium and this is amoeba. So here, they depend on others for food. They cannot produce their own food. Okay, so that is why they are called heterotrophs.
Let us begin with the study of kingdom fungi with the help of a small activity. Activity: take a moist slice of bread or bhakri and keep it in a container with lid for 2 to 3 days. After 2 to 3 days, what do you observe? We see fine cotton thread-like tuft growing on the surface of the bread. Take few of these threads on a clean glass slide. Put a drop of water on it and cover the threads with a clean cover slip. Observe this temporary mount under the compound microscope. What is observed under the microscope? We see thin, colorless, branched, thread-like filaments with black-colored rounded structures under the microscope.
So students, what did you observe under the microscope? We observed that after 2 to 3 days, you could see a fine cotton-like thread that is growing on the surface of that bread, right? And that is called fungi. So here, this is the diagram of fungi. Now students, let us look at the characteristics one by one. So the first characteristic is, these are non-green in color, that is the color of the fungus is not green. They are eukaryotic, they consist eukaryotic cells. And you know what is eukaryotic cells, right? They have distinct nucleus and cell organelles, a proper cell, okay? They are heterotrophic. That means that they depend on others for their nutrition, for food. In the video, you have seen that the fungus was growing on the bread. So for food, it was absorbing the nutrition from the bread. The second one is, most of them are saprotrophs. They feed upon decaying organic matters. Now students, there are various types of fungus that are found in the environment. So some of them are saprotrophs, which means that they feed or they get their nutrition from the decaying organic matter. Like if a organism is dead, they get their nutrition, they grow on that organism and they get their nutrition from them. So the third one is, their cell wall is made up of a tough and complex sugar called chitin. Now students, here chitin is a sugar, it is a complex sugar, and with the help of this sugar, a cell wall is built around the cell. So this sugar makes the cell wall very tough, very strong. The fourth one is, some fungi are thread-like and many nuclei are present in the cytoplasm. Now as you know that in the cell you have nucleus, mitochondria, vacuoles, then endoplasmic reticulum and so many other cell organelles which help the cell to survive. Out of all these cell organelles, cytoplasm is also one of it. So the fourth characteristic states that in the cells of the fungus or fungi, inside the cell, there is a cytoplasm. In that cytoplasm, there are many nuclei. Now, if we talk about an animal cell or a plant cell, there is only one nucleus. But inside the fungus cell, there are many nuclei in the cytoplasm. Then there are examples like baker's yeast. Now students, the bread which you eat, it has yeast in it. And yeast is nothing but a kind of fungus. It is not harmful and that is why we put it in the bread for fermentation. Then there is aspergillus, that is fungus on corn, penicillium, mushrooms. These are all examples of fungi. I hope the characteristics of Monera, Protista and fungi are clear to everyone. Now next, let's see how microbes are classified. Among the living organisms, microorganisms are the largest in number. Hence, they are classified as follows. Microorganisms are divided into two parts, that is again prokaryotes and eukaryotes. Under prokaryotes, we have only bacteria, while under eukaryotes, we have protista, fungi and algae. So now, first let us learn about bacteria. Now, the size of bacteria is 1 micrometer to 10 micrometer. Also, bacteria are unicellular, which means they are single-celled organisms. They can be independent or they can be also parasitic. Now, independent means that the bacteria does not depend on others for their food. Whereas parasitic is totally opposite of independent. They depend on other organisms for their food. Okay? Sometimes many bacteria together forms colonies. Now, sometimes in a particular area, If the bacteria is growing and increasing, then they can form colonies. Next is, they are reproduced by simple binary fission. The bacteria uses simple binary fission. Now, what is this simple binary fission? Look at this picture over here. Here you can see that there is a single cell. That is, this is a bacteria. So here you can see that there is only one cell, and in that one cell you can see that there is one DNA. But now when the bacteria wants to reproduce, they will replicate their DNA. So now here in the second cell you can see that there are two DNAs. Now after this, the DNA will get separated. As you can see over here, the DNA got separated. One DNA went to the left side, other DNA went to the right side. After that, you can see that two cells were formed, or two bacteria were formed. So this is called simple binary fission, where one cell replicates its DNA, and then when the DNA gets separated, and then two cells are formed. Now next we have, in favorable conditions, bacteria grow vigorously and can double their number in 20 minutes. Now, for a bacteria to grow, favorable conditions are needed. Now, this point says that if the conditions are favorable, then the bacteria in that area can grow in 20 minutes. Can grow. Now, this point says that if the conditions are favorable, like whatever condition is needed for a bacteria to reproduce or to grow, if that conditions are met, then bacteria grows vigorously. That means if in a particular area there is a favorable condition and there are something around 100 bacteria, but after 20 minutes, if you see, then there will be double of them. That is, there will be 200 bacteria. So the bacteria will keep on increasing. Bacterial cell is prokaryotic with cell wall, but distinct nucleus or cell organelles are absent. So this point says that since the cell is prokaryotic, we know that prokaryotic cell do not have distinct nucleus, or even the cell organelles are absent sometimes in the bacteria. So these are some examples of bacteria. First one is Coccus, Coccobacillus, Bacillus, Vibrio and Spirillum. Out of these examples, students learn any two or three examples, because if asked in the exam, you can write these examples. Now next, we will be learning about protozoa. The size of protozoa is approximately 200 micrometer. Protozoans are found in soil, fresh water and sea water. Some are found in body of other organisms and are pathogenic. Now, apart from soil, fresh water and sea water, they are also found in the body of other organisms and they are pathogenic. That means that they are harmful and cause certain diseases. These are unicellular organisms with eukaryotic cell. Now we know that unicellular means single cell organisms, and eukaryotic means they have well-defined nucleus and other cell organelles. There is a great variation in cell structure, organs of locomotion and modes of nutrition among protozoans. Now students, protozoa is not of one type. There are many types of protozoa, and so their cell structure will also be different. Their organs will also be different. The cell organelles will also be different. Then also the organs of locomotion, that is the organs which they use to move from one place to another, even they will differ. Along with that, even mode of nutrition. Now some protozoa prepare their own food, but some protozoa, they will depend on other organisms, other living organisms for their food. This organism reproduces by simple cell division. In simple cell division, the parent cell will divide itself into two cells. Okay, that is called simple cell division. Here are some examples. Amoeba and Paramoecium. They are free living in dirty water. You can find paramecium and amoeba in the dirty water. And they are free living, which means they do not depend on other organisms for their nutrition. Entamoeba histolytica. It causes amoebiasis. Now students, amoebiasis is a disease which is caused by this parasite, Entamoeba histolytica, and it is caused in the intestine. Next is Plasmodium vivax. It causes malaria. This type of protozoa is responsible for malaria. And last one is Euglena, which is autotrophic. This protozoa prepares its own food. So students, we will stop right here, and in the next video, we shall study about the remaining microbes, that is the fungi or fungus, algae, and also the viruses. Thank you everyone, and have a nice day.